Lecture 8 quiz review is on photosynthesis. This is one that's also fairly difficult if you don't know what you're looking for the quiz. As I mentioned with Lecture 7's quiz review, these are the harder lectures because it just ramps things up. So pay close attention as you're going forward here. There are some simple questions, but there are some hard questions as well. Some of the simpler questions are what goes into photosynthesis and what comes out. Sometimes I use the terms reactants or substrates, and then I use the term products. So reactants or substrates, that's light, carbon dioxide, water. Products are things like glucose and oxygen, right? So that's an easy one. But there's also some harder ones too, based upon what we've learned in the lecture. And that is things like, let's say I were to tag this oxygen right here, this carbon dioxide oxygen, with an isotope, meaning it's a different, heavier version of that atom, and we can distinguish it from the other atoms. And scientists have done this, and this is why I use this as a scenario. And I say, where does this oxygen end up? Well, that requires that you understand and remember what we've talked about in this lecture, and that is, where do the atoms go? So again, let's jump ahead real quick. Carbon dioxide, these atoms go into glucose. So that's what you would say, is that this oxygen would end up over here in glucose, not in this oxygen that is released as oxygen gas, and not into the water. That's one of the reactants, right? It's one of the reasons why this picture is such a good picture, is it illustrates the separation of some of these processes. So again, same thing. If I ask, if we tag this oxygen in water, where does it end up? It ends up in the air, the oxygen in the air. It doesn't end up in the glucose here. Okay, and they've done these experiments before. So that's another question. That's a harder question, is where does the oxygen go, right? There's another one that also illustrates a concept, and that is, I'll ask you where most of the organic mass of the plant comes from as it goes through this photosynthesis process. And I give you a little story about how these scientists were measuring the soil and determining how much nutrients were taken up from the soil, you know, ammonia, nitrate, and things like that. And they found that most of the biological mass didn't come from the soil. It came from the air, the carbon dioxide, because this glucose, remember, this is a precursor for all carbohydrates, but also the Calvin cycle is used to essentially make other things like amino acids and lipids and other things like that. So make sure that you understand that most of the biological organic mass that is incorporated into a plant basically comes from the air, from carbon dioxide. Now, there will be a question on photosynthetic pigments. Make sure you know the chlorophyll and carotenoids, because I'm going to test you on just some of the general wavelengths that are used. For example, chlorophyll absorbs blue and red, while carotenoids absorbs blue and green. So make sure you know the pigments as it relates to energy. You're not going to be given questions on all the different spectrum of energy, but you are going to be given questions on generally what colors these photosynthetic pigments absorb. And so make sure you understand chlorophyll and carotenoids. Those are the only two that are going to show up in this. Now, there's some hypothetical questions that are related to energy absorption that you're also going to get. I usually use a forest tree scenario with trees that have black leaves and white leaves and green leaves and orange and yellow leaves and all of that. And it comes down to the concept of energy absorption. So remember that if the leaves are black, that's the maximum amount of energy absorption because they're absorbing all visible light. That's why solar panels are black, is because they're trying to absorb all visible light to turn it into electrical energy. Whereas plants, they have to have this trade-off, too much energy absorption, and it causes the plant to heat up, and that's not good. And that's generally why they don't absorb all visible light, but they absorb as much as they can handle, and that's generally the chlorophyll pigments are the optimal for that. That's why most photosynthetic organisms are green, because green is one of the least absorbed wavelengths of light. Now, other questions may ask which colored leaves are absorbing the least And now this is a hypothetical question. And in those, you would look for the white leaves because white, remember, is a reflection of all visible light. That's why you go outside on a hot day with a white shirt, not a black shirt. Otherwise, you're going to get hotter than what you normally would because your shirt pigment would be absorbing more energy. So you wear a white shirt because it reflects most of the visible light and doesn't cause it to, the material to heat up. There are other questions, though, that may say, oh, the chlorophyll doesn't break down. What color are the leaves of the forest? Well, in that case, it'd be green, because if there's still chlorophyll in the in the leaves, then they're going to reflect green while absorbing the other wavelengths of light. So that is a question that everyone's going to get to, a hypothetical, you know, forest question that basically teaches you the principles of energy absorption as we've been talking about the different wavelengths of energy, but how it applies, especially to plants. Now, the other questions you're going to get are on some of the particulars of photosynthesis, photosystem 2, photosystem 1, chemiosmotic phosphorylation, where water is involved. Remember, when water is not available, everything shuts down, not just ATP and NADPH production, but also the Calvin cycle, because where's the Calvin cycle going to get energy if not from the light reactions? So everything shuts down if there's no water. Sometimes I refer to the light reactions as the thylakoid reactions, and sometimes I refer to the Calvin cycle reactions as the stroma reactions. Why? Well, like in the beginning, we talked about some of the parts of the chloroplast. The thylakoids are where the light reactions take place. And the stroma is the fluid that the Calvin cycle takes place in, okay? So I use those interchangeably at times. So just keep an eye out for that. Make sure that you know that the antenna complex is the chlorophyll and the carotenoids. Sometimes people just miss that process that I talk about. The antenna complex is the pigments. Think about it. It's like a radio antenna. It picks up the radio signals, and then you're able to interpret the information. Well, the chlorophyll and the carotenoids are the antenna complex. They absorb the light energy, and then they are able to transfer to an electron, which travels out the reaction center and then down the electron transport chain. Make sure you know which one does what. Photosystem 2 makes ATP through chemiosmotic phosphorylation. Photosystem 1 makes NADPH. No special name for that one. The Calvin cycle, make sure you know the name of the enzyme that starts it. It's called Rubisco. A lot of times people confuse Rubisco with the sugar called RUBP. Why? Well, they get their names after each other. Rubisco is the shorthand for ribulose biphosphate carboxylase oxygenase. Yeah, nobody wants to say that, right? So we call it Rubisco. Well, ribulose biphosphate, RUBP, that's the sugar. So people always confuse those two. Rubisco, enzyme. RUBP, sugar. So Rubisco combines carbon dioxide with RUBP. Make sure you know that. And the only reason why I want you to know that is because of the C4 pathway and the discussion we had on photorespiration. That's the only reason. You don't even need to know all these other enzymes that are involved in this process. Over here, make sure you understand that in PGAL synthesis, the energy comes from the light reactions. This is where ATP and NADPH from the light reactions gives its energy to energize these molecules. And then a couple of them can be made into amino acids or glucose or lipids or whatever the plant needs, right? It's not just sugar that the plant's making through photosynthesis. One question on photorespiration. Make sure you understand that the C4 pathway is in addition to the Calvin cycle. It does not replace the Calvin cycle. I will not distinguish between C4 and CAM plants and all of that. Just make sure you understand that 95% of the plants on the planet don't use the C4 pathway. They just use the Calvin cycle. 100% of the plants on the planet use the Calvin cycle, but only 5% use the C4. These are the C4 pathway. These are the ones that live in the desert. that have to avoid photorespiration. And this is what photorespiration is. They conserve water. Oxygen builds up through the photosynthesis process. It interrupts Rubisco's ability to combine carbon dioxide with the sugar. And instead of capturing carbon dioxide, they release it and you get to this stalemate. And that's why the C4 pathway is a traffic workaround to capture carbon dioxide separate from Rubisco so that the Calvin cycle can keep making that even when oxygen starts building up in these cells. Okay. So that's the only one that's a little difficult. All the others are pretty straightforward, but make sure you understand the different parts of these processes. About, you know, half the questions are pretty straightforward. The other half require you to do some critical thinking, which is kind of the point of all of this, is to think about how all of this matters and why it matters and how it applies and everything.